Hello everyone, I would like to welcome you to this session about an introduction to the Qt Creator. Tobias Hunger is presenting this. Mm-hmm. Please applaud.
Yeah. Thank you. Can you hear me? Does the microphone work well? Yeah. Okay, so welcome to my presentation about Qt Creator. Why am I presenting this topic? Let me introduce myself, please. So my name is Tobias Hunger. I got into the Qt world a couple of years back when some guy called Matthias Ettrich wrote a mail that he wants to do a development desktop environment for the Unix platform. That was about 15 years ago. So at that time I got to know about Qt and made a couple of tutorials, but in earnest I only got into the whole thing about 6 years ago when I joined a consulting company, which is also presenting downstairs. Since then I'm basically working full-time with the Qt libraries. About 3 years ago I joined Nokia and became part of this group of people. That's my co-workers here in Berlin. We are the team doing all the tooling in Qt Creator, in Qt, including Qt Creator and all the other tools we have, like Linguist and everything else. So what do I want to show today? So the first thing I want to cover is some quick introduction. What is Qt Creator and why are we doing that? Then the majority of this presentation will be a demonstration of how I work with Qt Creator, how I think you should work with Creator. If you have questions, please feel free to interrupt me at any time. And so after the presentation, I wanted to highlight some new features in Qt Creator that I will not be able to properly show in the setup. And finally, I want to provide some links where you can get more information and download and all that stuff. So, who of you has already used Creator before? Yes. Oh, that's quite a lot. So, would you guys mind if I reduce the introduction part a bit and go more for the new features? Oh, okay. So. What is Qt Creator? So Creator is a full-featured integrated development environment. So if that means you can manage your projects, you have a powerful editor. I mean, you work with code, that's basically editing text, so you need a very powerful text editor. We have syntax highlighting for major languages. We have code completion. And all the major tools you're going to need during development are integrated into one nice package. So that includes help for all the Qt things and others, version control, and of course debugging. But this list is pretty much true for any integrated development environment. So why are we doing our own? So, and that's basically because Qt Creator is, in my opinion at least, the development environment for Qt development. We are targeting and supporting all the major languages you need to create a Qt application, which of course is C++, but nowadays also includes QML and JavaScript and the GL shader language. Qt Creator knows about all the specialties of Qt, like signals and slots and all the other stuff we have. It has support for Qt data types, for debugging and all that. All the major Qt tools are integrated, and that of course includes the designer for widget application creation. And it's a cross-platform tool. And to me, that's a very important thing, because as a Qt developer, I routinely switch between Windows, Mac, Linux, whatever. And it's really nice to have the same environment on all those platforms and not having to switch all the time between Xcode, Visual Studio, and whatever you want to use on Linux. But there's another aspect to this cross-platform thing as well. With Qt Creator, we want to support Qt developers, and a majority of, or quite a few of those, are actually working with embedded devices or mobile phones and all that stuff. So we want to support that kind of development as well. So we have a very strong focus on working with other devices and making that easy and seamless. So there's some secondary considerations that we had when we started working on it. So we wanted it to be an environment which we like to work with, because most of our team are actually working with Qt Creator at least 8 hours a day. And we wanted to be keyboard usable, keyboard navigatable, so because it's just so much simpler once you get used to it to use a keyboard instead of the mouse. And I'll be highlighting quite a few keyboard combinations during my demonstration. So let's find out. I'm going to show Qt Creator 2.6 that was released, I think, on Friday, or was it Thursday? I'm not sure. Last week. So it's the latest and greatest we have. I'm not having any patches on top of it, so it's really what you get when you start it. This is built on top of Qt 4, but it works equally well on top of Qt 5. So how does it look like? Well, pretty normal. I mean, the first thing you might notice is that even on a small screen like this, this is 1024 times 700 pixels, it's still usable and has still a wide central widget where you can actually do your work in. So we try to keep the number of tooltips and all that, and tool buttons and everything are low, so you can focus on your code and don't have all that stuff. So, what do you see at the? Can you see the mouse cursor here? So at the top we have a normal menu bar like basically all the other applications as well. And here on the side we have the mode buttons. These are allow you to switch between different, well, we call them modes. It's basically development tasks rather easily. So at the moment we are here up here in welcome mode, which is just a friendly welcome page to make people feel at home and get them started with Qt development. So we have introductory topics here. You can access examples and tutorials as well. And so below these mode buttons, we have a kit selector down here, which is a fast way to switch between different projects and configurations. I'll show that later. Then we have a couple of buttons to run and debug and build your application. And finally, down here, we have the locator, which is a very central element to navigating code in Creator, and I will show that later. And a couple of output panes, which will be used to show all kinds of different outputs that you will run into when working with your code, like debugger, compiler outputs, and all kinds of things. So there's one special flag I used when I started Qt Creator for you today. That's the presentation mode. That's just a very a small change which will pop up in the center of the screen, the keyboard combinations that I'm going to use. So since we are very proud that it's keyboard usable, that's a very nice way to make it visible what I'm actually doing, because you obviously can't see what I'm typing here. So the very first shortcut is escape. So escape will always take you closer to your code. So in this case, it switched to edit mode where we don't have any projects open yet. So there is nothing really to see yet, but in edit mode, you will be able to see your code and work with that there. So I wanted to highlight a couple of configuration settings, because we keep getting questions about or people asking about features, and sometimes we can just point them to to the configuration so they can change it. So I want to highlight a couple of things for you guys. On Linux and Windows system, that's the configuration is accessible by tools options. So Mac put it somewhere else. I think it's Qt Creator Preferences. I'm not a Mac user, I'm sorry. So if you get into Qt Creator, I really recommend going through the settings once just to familiarize with yourself with what it can do and to change whatever you want to do. But there are a couple of things that are more interesting to look at others. And the first one is environment keyboard up here. See that? Okay. So this is basically where all the keyboard shortcuts we have are defined. And when I scroll down here, you will notice that quite a few actions don't have any keyboard shortcut at all. So if you're missing some functionality, it's worth looking here. Maybe it's already there, it's just not accessible by default. So check there, please. There's also another area which is rather interesting in my opinion is the text editor, which has a tab fonts and colors, which is used to define the syntax highlighting we use. Creator does support quite a few different things. Some of them are not enabled basically, but they are highlighting, but they use the same color as everything else. So if you're missing something, it's worth looking here. Maybe you can just turn it on. And some other feature, which is very cool, is our generic highlighter. So we do support semantic highlighting based on a code model for C++, QML, JavaScript, and GL shader language. But you might want to use other languages as well. And to access those or to make those highlighting based or highlighted based on regular expressions. So that's no code model, but it's still a huge help. You can go here and download further definitions. So that's especially for Linux users, we will detect some of them by default if they have KDE installed because it's based on the Qt text editor. But for Windows users and Mac users, it might be worthwhile just to download definitions here and just grab the whole set. They have really good highlighters for XML and all kinds of stuff. They are really useful. So please try that. And finally, in this kit, configuration area, I wanted to highlight kits, which is a new feature we have in 2.6. So if you have used Qt Creator 2.5 before, you might have noticed what we called targets, which were basically predefined groups of configurations that for all kinds of different devices we had, like Symbian and Migo and whatnot. But these were defined in code and were basically fixed and not editable. And in Creator 2.6, we replaced that concept with kits, which is basically a set of configurations which you can reuse between projects, and you define them once for basically a device, and then you are able to reuse them everywhere and switch between those devices very fast and switch between kits very fast. So in my opinion, that's very convenient, especially if you work with different devices, different compilers, and all that stuff. So let's just set up a new kit. By default, we have a desktop kit, which is using everything we detect in your path, like the compiler, Qt version, and stuff, and will work with your local desktop. But let's do some more. So let's check compilers first. These are the compilers Creator detected while starting up. And I have a GCC and a CLang compiler installed here. I'm pretty happy with that so far. So let's check the Qt versions. I only have one that was found. But let's set up a kit using the other compiler. So at the moment, as you can see down here, we're using a GCC-based 64-bit compiler. But I can just clone this kit, rename it to whatever I want, and just replace the compiler here. And then I have a new kit with a C-Lang compiler, and I can easily switch between compilers now. Any question about kits? Was it okay? So let's get started with loading a project. And since I'm a Qt Creator developer, and I've needed a medium-sized project to show code navigation with, I think it's pretty obvious that I'm going to use Qt Creator. And here it is. And I can just open the project very simply by opening the .pro file, which is a QMake build system file. And that's another area I'm really proud of in Creator, that it integrates very well with command line tools. So we don't have any special settings in Creator, and we don't have any special project file format. We basically work with QMake files as they are, and you can also, when working with Creator, are also able to build your project on the command line, which is rather important, especially if you have a CI system or some test servers or want to run nightly builds or whatever. So you can just, you don't need a special Creator setup and automate it. You can just use a script running a couple of command line commands to get your binaries. So let's open it. That will take a while. It's a medium-sized project, so. And so now it's loaded, and this main area here is split into two parts. This one here is called the sidebar, which we use for navigation aids. So you're right now you're seeing the project structure, which is basically the structure of all the project files and all the files that those include. So you can open those up, but there are other views as well. So the Windows is a bit small, so it's abbreviated a bit. We also have a file system view and a class view, which helps you with your navigation inside the project. And we have some other views which help for with navigation inside a file, which is the outline, which will basically show a view of all those defined things in that file. But so let's start with opening something. So let's use the graphical tools, the Project Explorer. I'm looking for the Project Explorer code in this case. So I know it's in plugins, Project Explorer, where is it? Here it is. And I care about header files, and the whole thing is called project-explorer.h. So this is a, can you read the font? Okay. So that's a source file, and if you look here, you will notice one thing straight away. And that is that Creator enables or supports code folding. And by default, we will fold the first comment or the comment at the start of the file, because we assume it's copyright information, and copyright information is important, but quite frankly, I don't know any developer who cares about it too much. So we just fold that away. You also see that we do syntax highlighting, and we do semantic highlighting as well. So if I do something strange, you might notice this wiggly underline here, which says there's something fishy here. I can hover and get some explanation what's wrong. And that, of course, also works with syntax errors. Let's add one. And then you will get a red wiggly underline telling you right away that your code is wrong, without the need to actually run a compiler. So, what would I want to check? Let me show you a bit how you can navigate your code. For that, we have a couple of, we can do that with a mouse as well, but we have a couple of keyboard shortcuts which are really convenient. The first one is F4, which just switches between the implementation file you see up here, so this is the CPP file, and the header file. It's very straightforward, but very useful. Inside your file, you can navigate with this drop-down list here, which basically lists all the functions that are defined in this file. So it's a very quick way to jump somewhere. There's another very nice key combination, which is follow symbol under cursor. You can trigger that with the mouse, I think. We're pressing Control and then hovering. Or you just press F2, which is way more convenient, and it will take you from the definition to the implementation and back. There's some to go to switch between files you had opened before. There are a couple of arrows up here to go back and forward in your history. But you can also do a control tab, and then you get a nice little window with the last files, and you can select those. And while all these is very convenient, the really cool thing about Creator is the locator we have down here, which makes all these tasks even simpler. So you can activate it by just pressing Control-K. And yeah, you get a list of different things you can execute. So the very simple thing, is you can just type in a file name like projectnotes.h and just go there. You can also use it to go to a class like I'm looking for a class name like. Let's go for the Project Explorer plugin. You can go to methods. You can open the help wizard. So that's basically the central mechanism I recommend to use if you want to navigate around, because it's keyboard usable. You don't have to use the mouse too much and open all kinds of. I mean, you have seen how long it took to open a Project Explorer file with a project tree. You can just type the file name. I mean, usually you know the file name. If you don't know the file name, you know the class name. So you can just type it in and you are there. There's also there's another very neat feature of the locator, which is a dot, which looks for local methods defined in this file, and you can just select them and jump there directly. So, and are there any questions about navigation issues, how to navigate code? I mean, those are the main features I wanted to show. Is there anything? We had so many people using Creator. Is there anything you use a lot that I missed? Yes?
I have a question of my own. Why you do that in that way? For example, used a long time Eclipse.
Yes.
And the first thing what I want to know is I start with, I have different workspaces.
Yes.
So I want to see, okay, I have that workspace with so much projects in there, and some projects don't need to close them. And so in this case, I always have to open my project every time. So I open to first open that project and I open that way. Why you don't decide to make workspaces instead of an empty line of
We have sessions for that, and I wanted to show that later. But basically, you can save the complete state your creator is in, including all the open projects, all the open files, all the locations, and save those as a session, and then open them at startup. Yes.
As left panel is right on the project view.
Yes.
Is there a key combination to change the view there?
Oh, I'm not. Do you guys know? No, control op is open, but you can do alt 0 and it will go away and you can open it again. I'm not really sure whether there's a keyboard combination. I think there is, but I can't remember it. Yes? Over there?
If you right click on a function, you can search for every usage of the function. Is it also possible now with signals and slots? Because signals and slots don't get found if they are used in a connect statement.
So the question was that we have find usages, but the guy over there claims that it doesn't work with signals on slots. So I'm not really sure. Let's try it. So do we have a signal here? Oh, where did they go here? No. Let me search. I'm sorry, this is a new laptop. It's driving me crazy because I keep touching the touchpad while typing. And that will steal the focus. So let's try this one here. Find the usages, and at least it has the emits. It didn't find the connects. Yeah, you're right, it's not found. So, have you filed a bug report about that? Please file a bug report. Any more questions? Yes?
And the alphabet sorting of the quick drop down of the functions, is there a way to enable it by default?
Which sorting? Up here? This one here? I'm
right clicking on this drop-down.
Mm-hmm.
You can sort alphabetically.
Yes.
Is there a possibility to make this default accurate? Because I have to accurate every in every class
I'm not aware, but I can check. So please get me your contact information. I will ask the guy who voted. Because I mostly use Control-K and just type in the function name I care about and or use follow symbols to get there. Any more questions? Yes?
Refactoring?
That's next on my list. So I was asked about refactoring operations, so let's get started with those. The first one, and I already showed it because I was asked about it, is find usages, which is a very convenient thing. So I can basically, these are private variables, so let's just find all the usages of this M instance variable. I just press Ctrl-Shift-U, and Creator will use its code model to find all the instances. So this is not a search, it's really looking for that specific symbol. So we have a code model, and we know, even if there are other variables with the same name in other classes and somewhere, it will only find those that you're actually looking for, so it's not a search. And that's already a very convenient feature. But of course, if you can search for it, you also want to be able to change it. And for that, we have Ctrl-Shift-R, which allows you to actually change the whole thing. So I can just rename it to, let's call it instance variable. And you can check, make sure that it's actually found the right things here, down here. So. And just replace it, and you will see that this variable is renamed here, and in all the other places it's used in the program as well. This also works for methods, so let's try that. Now, restore session sounds so stupid, let's rename that. or let's call it restore workplace, workspace. Workspace was what it's called in Eclipse. So let's just rename that. So now we have a restore workplace session, and it's actually updated everywhere in the code. Oh, that's already a very convenient feature. We also have something called quick fixes built in our creator for quite a while now, which is small tweaks that you can do to your code. Let's, for example, decide this is restore workplace absolutely needs an integer parameter or called param. So I can just trigger that and say apply function signature changes. And when I then follow to the decision, it's already updated there. So let's actually use that. So this param. So now we actually use that parameter. And if you go back here and decide param is a pretty generic name, so let's rename that to debug me. You can again update it and follow the symbol. And you will see it's updated here, and all its usages are updated as well down here. And that's a very convenient feature we have for, I think it's new in this version actually. So, and I find that really, really useful and a real time saver. There are, of course, other refactoring operations. So, for example, you can mark strings as string literal. If you've been to the presentation about C++ development, then you know that you should use that in Qt 5 because it's way faster. Or you can mark a string as translatable, which will do the right thing for you depending on what kind of object it is. If it's a Q object, it will just at a TR like it did here. Let me undo that. And if it's not a Q object, it will use a Q core application and for a string constants, some macro. I'm sorry, I need some water. So it actually understands your code and it will do the right thing for you. That's very convenient, and we have quite a few more of them. There's small things like change conditions in if statements if they have and in it to be two if statements and refactor that kind of things. And other small things are here and there to make it more convenient to code. So anything you guys are using that I should show? No? Is nobody using quick fixes yet? You should, it's really cool.
One thing which happened to me is that I tried to change the list.
Yes?
And even the source code of Qt was changed.
Yes, so. So the comment was that he changed a queue list, and we were very sorry and actually fixed all of Qt for him. And it looks like it wasn't appreciated too much. Well, of course, you could always make your Qt read-only, then we can't do that. But yes, that can happen. It happened to me before, too. I think I replaced all Qt strings. We have version control system. So if there's nothing else about, it's another.
Like about adding function definition from the header.
That works, yes, you can do that.
You can do one, but can you do like three or four in one click?
No, that's missing. But we are very open to contributions, and I would personally love to see that. There's also something I miss dearly is implementing having a quick fix which puts all the pure virtual methods that you inherited in the code. I'm really missing that. Yes?
Isn't the background your refactoring already based on Clang?
No, our the question is whether we're based on Clang yet. No, we are not. We still use our own code model. There are plans to, we have people looking into C-Lang, but so far it's just too slow. So it takes about 20 minutes to get Creator parsed fully. And in those 20 minutes, the code completion is just too flaky. So we would need to do some caching of all the state information or whatever. And that's something we so far do not do, because our code model is just fast enough to just parse it on startup. So we don't need to have checks the cache, whether the cache is still fresh and all that stuff. So we would probably need to add that for CLang. Yes? Mm-hmm. Well, that should use a normal system font that's used up here too. So, I'm not aware of option to do that. More questions? Yes.
I just noticed that in the environment settings general, there is only English as language.
Tools, options, environment. Is there a lot more for me?
I just downloaded it. I just got the most recent version.
Yes.
For Qt 5.
I'm not sure what the most recent version for Qt 5 is. I think it should be the same one I'm using. So we need to check that out later. Okay. So any more questions? Then I wanted to do a quick jump into version system integration. Nothing too deep, just to show that we actually have it. So if you go to tools, you will notice that we have, oh my god. Yeah, it's 1024 times 700 pixels, so who uses that anymore, quite seriously. But it's still really, really usable on such a small screen, so that's something not all IDEs can do. So, thank you. we will only, let me get here back here. We will only show the version control system that's actually used in a project. So in this case, it's only Git. If you don't use a version control system, there's a chance that some more than one will show up. That's just to allow to set up the initial repository for it. And once you set it up, only that system will show up. So we do support a wider range of version control systems. We use Git quite heavily, but there's also Mercurial, Bazaar, Subversion, CVS, and a lot of others. And yeah, so we can do all the common operations like blame. So you can see who actually did which code. I mean, the Windows is a bit small, so actually all the code is back here. And you can find out what each of these changes actually is with an explanation and everything. It's integrated, it works. Something else, and you already brought it up, is it's rather inconvenient to just open up Creator with an empty state. I fully agree there. So we don't have workspaces as Eclipse does. So what we try to do, or what we do, is we use sessions. There's a session manager here. You can actually define new sessions and switch between sessions. You basically just clone an existing one, and then you can configure it or whatever you want, and open all the files you need and whatever, set bookmarks, breakpoints in your code, and all that stuff. And you can go here and click restore last session on startup, and whenever you start Creator, you will have the same state that you left in, which some people like, others don't. I personally don't like it, because when I close Creator and open it, I'm switching between tasks basically. So I don't want the old stuff around anymore. But let's switch to some small debug session. Let's just switch to it. No, I do not want to save all the stuff that I broke. And you can see here, it saved the project I'm in, it saved the files that were open, and it also, where are the breakpoints? It also saved the breakpoints. So this is just a small test application we use to test the debugger with. So what I want to highlight with this part of the demonstration is our debugging capabilities. So we just press debug, and I'll hide away this sidebar to have a bit more room. And as you can see, we do support quite a few Qt built-in types, or like we have a Q file here, Q file information, and a Q string, and you see them with their value right here, which is very convenient already. One trap I ran into recently is some of these debugger things depend on the debugging symbols for Qt being available. Not all of them do, but basically all the objects that have a dpointer or that will need a debug version of Qt, otherwise we are not able to extract the information we need to do this highlighting or to do the analysis and get the content out. So as you can see, it works pretty well for simple data types. So let's go to some more complex ones. So we have a Q hash of string or Q list integer here. And you can already see there were three values inserted. And you can look at those values too. So the keys, the values, and this one is pretty boring, there's nothing in it. This one is a bit more complex, so you can access the list. That's really convenient, and all these data extraction methods, please correct me if I'm wrong there, are based on a Python script, so it's pretty easy to extend for custom data types if you have some. So you don't really need to do complex plugins to actually add data types here. We cover quite a few of the Qt data types and also quite a bit of the stuff in the STD namespace, like STD map and stuff.
Are there any examples to extend? Because I tried it several times. Sometimes it works, sometimes not, and it's changing.
Well, it depends on the GDB you're using. So we have our own script that we use to extract all the Qt values is available and it's loaded. So that can be a guide to how to actually do it.
Okay. And it's in the creator directory?
It's installed in, I think, Andre, where are the dumper scripts installed exactly? So share, Qt creator, debugger, and then the Python files there, or Python file there. And so a Q hash is already a pretty complex data type, but let's do something fun. We have a Q image here. So, and you see, we extract the value, it's 200 times 200 pixels. But actually, we can do something really cool. Let's just put it to displayed. That's my window manager is a bit strange, so that should be a normal sized window, but yeah. So let's just step through the code here. What are we doing? So we have the Q image up here, we have a Q painter, and we started with setPen. Let's just step through the code. So next thing is draw ellipse, and that's what it does, it draws an ellipse. So you can actually follow the Q image as it's painted. So I think it's really cool. So let's do some more painting. And let me hit the right thing. Yeah, and there you go. So you can actually do quite a lot with this data dampers, and I fully recommend looking into those. But as I said before, some of them require a debug build of Qt. So if you only see a dpointer mentioned here, that's a sure sign that you need a debug build. Yes?
You're really meaning a debug build of Qt, or you meaning build of this debug helper?
a debug build of Qt. We use Python scripts now. We don't need debug helpers anymore.
Okay.
So, any more questions about debugging? Yes? The Visual Studio compilers, they require a different debugger. Do we do the complex?
Yes, for some of the types, there's also an extension here, which does essentially the same, but the mechanism to check the is completely different.
So, Andre just said it's the result should be similar, but the mechanism is completely different. Yes?
How to install another version control?
We ship with a wide range of those. The question was about version control systems, so about plugins basically has the list. Where are the version control systems? Down here. So we ship all these. If you actually use one of these, you are fine. Otherwise, we very much welcome your contribution to add another one. So it doesn't seem to be too hard. We had recently, the ClearCase plugin here was contributed by one guy in Israel. The Mercurial one was also contributed, as well as the Bazaar one. So it's not too hard to do. Any more questions? Yes?
We can do
cross-platform remote debugging. So it mostly depends on the target you want to debug. So if it's embedded Linux, that works fine, yes. Any more questions? Yes?
Do you have any plans to integrate things like TFS? I mean, source control system is a version control system is only a small subset of what is needed today. Like reporting who has changed what from the creator, for instance.
So basically, advanced
advanced reporting,
team management and reporting features.
Absolutely.
We don't have. I'm not aware of any plans to do that currently, but it's an interesting aspect, and we had already had some people suggested before, and some even committed to actually do something, but so far nothing showed up. But we are an open source project, so everybody is invited to participate. Yes?
Yeah. Another question about, do you also, well, maybe you already have it, but can you do cross-compiling for desktop platforms?
The question is whether we can do cross-compiling for desktop platforms. In theory, yes, but there's no easy out-of-the-box way to actually do it, just because it's rather tricky to set up. And
is there a kind of tutorial or example? Did somebody actually do this?
I know that some guy was using MinGW on Linux to build Windows binaries, but I'm not sure that we have documentation on it. Is it documented?
Sort of works out of the box. The main problem is you need a compiler. You need a working cross compiler, you need a working tool chain, and then you set up a new kit and then it works.
Yeah, but that's exactly the problem. Maybe there would be some pre work done already or something work and look at it.
So the comment was that it's basically you need a toolchain, and that's once you have that and it works, it's pretty easy to integrate into Creator. Yes.
On that subject, is it possible to set up a kit that does not use Qt at all? I want to compile down to bare metal microcontrollers, for example, as part of a big project. And want to be able to use this fine tool with everything in the infrastructure, but not use the Qt libraries. I haven't been able to find anybody that succeeded in this.
Well, let's build and run. So the question was whether it's possible to not use Qt.
Yeah.
And let me answer that by doing this. Does that answer your question?
Is that new?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, any more questions? Yeah?
Actually, two questions. First, how to enable the presentation mode, and are the settings for the presentation mode stored separately to the normal settings?
So the presentation mode, a question about presentation mode, to enable it, you pass minus presentation mode, and that's the only way to enable it. No, there's no setting. I mean, really, it doesn't really make sense except in a setup like this. Do you really want to see your key presses all the time? There's no way yet, so yeah, one more question, then I need to go on with the presentation because I'm running
out. Also the Intel compiler?
We can use the Intel compiler, at least on Linux it should debug fine. I'm not so sure how it works on Windows, though. So let me go back to my slides, and I still have a couple more. So just to summarize what I tried to show during the demonstration, check tools options, or I think on the Mac it's preference, acute creator preferences, something like that. You want to make sure if you miss something, some functionality, check environment keyboard. If you miss some highlighting, check tool text editor, fonts and colors. Use Control K. It's the most convenient feature we have. It's really great. It takes some getting used to, I know, but once you do, you will really miss it everywhere else. There's F2, F4, and a couple of other keys for navigation things. So I hope you take home. We have keyboard shortcuts for almost everything, and you will forget the details anyway. And check out quick fixes. And final piece of advice. And that's where I burned all my special effects budget, so it's really important. Read the documentation. So we have Lena here from the documentation team. She does an awesome job at kicking all of us to at least tell her when we do some new stuff so she can actually document it. So just some new things in Qt Creator 2.6, which I wasn't really able to show here. It's the first Qt Creator version that's actually able to be used with Qt 5. There were quite a lot of changes in Qt 5, so the project structure is more modular, and that needs quite a bit of adapting, so actually Creator is actually able to use a Qt version. So if you use Qt 5, please use Qt Creator 2.6. You will run into trouble otherwise. We have improved C++ 11 support. It's not completely done yet, but the major features should be there. I think we are in good company there. We have kits, which is a major improvement in my opinion over what we had before with the targets, and makes it way more flexible to actually work with different devices. We have experimental Android support. That was contributed by Bogdan from the Necessitas project. We have QNX support, which was contributed by Rim and KDAP. And we have support for the ClearCase version system for the first time in 2.6, which was contributed by Orgard from AudioCodex in Israel. And we have initial support for code review tools like Garrett. So that's what we use in Qt 5 quite heavily. So it's natural that we start to look and investigate how to make that a bit more convenient to use for us. There are lots and lots of smaller features, but you will discover them when you use Qt Creator. And some links. So. You can download it in the usual place. The manual is also in the documentation side at the usual place. And there's actually a reference card, not done by us, but by KDAP, which was recently updated to Qt Creator 2.6 and has some information on kit setup as well. So it's really convenient to have around. So and that's all I wanted to show. So thank you for your many questions. And I hope to learn something or saw something new.